Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking all about the accounting cycle. We've talked about all the different elements of the cycle, and then in the last two segments, we've been talking about converting cash to accruals or accruals to cash. And in our last segment specifically, we started doing an example, this example. Step one, you remember, is to go through the balance sheet accounts and calculate the change in cash that comes from that change in a balance sheet account, and we did that here. So as accounts receivable went down, cash goes up. Why? Well, because somebody probably paid me. As accounts payable went up, cash went up. Why? Because if I owe more to my vendors, then I didn't send them a check. So obviously I have more money. So we did all of those changes, not for every account, just for the ones that deal with day-to-day operations. The other long-term stuff, we didn't worry about. We'll deal with that later when we do a full-blown statement of cash flow. Then we set up the worksheet, and I want you to pay special attention to this worksheet, since the use of this worksheet is a key concept in the way we're learning cash flows. It's such a simple and straightforward way to do cash flows. We're going to continue on with step three, and with step three, we're putting in the information that we know. Now, in this case, the example is called converting accruals to cash. So obviously, I'm going to be starting with this accrual column and then changing to the cash column. So I'm going to be moving this way, just because of the title. The other way you know, though, is by looking at your income statement. If you have a traditional income statement, then you have accrual information. Income statements are set up to do accruals. So if you're seeing things like sales, interest revenue, COGS, and expenses, then you've got accrual information. So what I'm going to do, step three, is I'm going to move this information down into my worksheet. And if you're doing it in Excel, you can type it in. If you're doing it by hand, go ahead and write it in. I'm just going to go through and write it in as quickly as I can so that we don't spend a lot of time with just copying. Okay? But if you need to pause and take a little extra time to think through it or to do it, go ahead. So let me scroll back down here. Let's see, we've got sales revenue, and that's $8,400. We've got interest revenue, $300. We've got cost of goods sold, and I'm going to stop right here and just mention one thing we haven't talked about yet with the worksheet, and that is in order to make the worksheet work, that's an awkward way to say that, isn't it? But in order for the worksheet to be effective, that's better, you have to put in the information as either positive or negative. So revenues, profits coming in, that's a positive number. Cost of goods sold, the other expenses, that's an outflow. We're going to show those as negative. Again, you want to make sure that you get your numbers in with the right sign. Otherwise, the equations aren't going to work. In this case, cost of goods sold is $4,300, and I'm going to put that in as a negative. And cost of goods sold usually takes a couple of adjustments, so I'm going to leave a space there. We've got a salary expense. Again, it's an expense, so it's negative for $400. We have an office expense, $300. Income tax expense, $200. Depreciation expense, $25. And rent expense, $300. And I'm pretty sure that I got everything here, but take a second and make sure that if you add up that column, you get net income. So let's see, 8,400 plus 300 minus 43 minus, let's see. Yep, looks like we come out just fine, 3,175, just like we should. So that's step three. Step four, we're going to match up the changes that we have up here in step one with the accrual lines that we have down here. So let's start with accounts receivable. If you had to match up accounts receivable with one of these line items, what would you match it with? Probably with sales. So we've got a change in accounts receivable, and it was a positive $350. And I'm going to go up and I'm going to check off that I've used that one. Where would you match up interest receivable? Probably with interest revenue. So I'm going to check that off. And I'm going to come down here, and this is my change an interest receivable, and it was a negative 200. Next, let's go up. Let's see. We have inventory change for 400. Inventory really would match up with an inventory expense. It's one of the few expenses that has a clever name. We call it cost of goods sold. So let's go ahead and put that one right here. So we have a change in inventory, negative 400. So now that's been used. Prepaid rent probably will match up with rent expense. So change in prepaid rent, positive 100. We'll check that off. Now I have two more. I have accounts payable and I have income tax payable. Income tax payable is the easier of the two. It matches up with income tax expense. So let's go ahead and get that down there. Change in income tax payable. And it was $500. And the last one was a change in accounts payable. And, you know, accounts payable is really going to depend on the company. What do they keep in their accounts payable? For all of our discussions over this whole series of Intermediate Accounting Part 1, we're going to use accounts payable just for the purchase and sale of inventory. We're going to keep wages payable and salaries payable and income tax payable. All the other payables, we're going to keep them separate while we're learning. Some companies you can't do that with. They put all of the payables together under that accounts payable line, and then this doesn't work as well. But for us, at least, we're only going to use accounts payable for our cost of goods sold or our inventory, and that's what we're going to line it up with, is our cost of goods sold. So our change in accounts payable is 100 positive. There's one other thing that you need to be aware of, and that is depreciation. Depreciation keeps track of the wear and tear on our equipment. When was the cash involved with that equipment? It isn't happening with the wear and tear. It happens back when I bought it. That's when I paid cash for it, not now with depreciation. There is never any cash effect from depreciation. So when I see depreciation expense, I just need to get rid of it. I'm going to cancel it out. So it's a negative, I'm going to put in a positive so that it goes away. And that's just something you need to look for. There's actually four of these: depreciation, amortization, gains, and losses. Don't ever have a cash effect. So when you're changing from accruals to cash, you've got to get rid of them. If you see them, you can just cancel them out. Last step then is to complete. And if you remember, the equation here is the accruals plus the change gives me cash flows. So let's see, 8,400 plus 350 gives me a positive 8,750, and we call that cash received from customers. Then we take 300 minus 200, or plus a negative 200 gives me $100 cash received as interest. That's how we do this. And the translation here is we earned $300 worth of interest, but people haven't paid us yet. So even though we earned $300, checks have only come in for $100 worth. Now, cost of goods sold, we have two adjustments here. And I have a rule for myself because of these equations, and I've got negative numbers and positive numbers and plus, and it could be minus if I'm going the other way. I always net out the change before I do the overall equation. So in this case, negative 400 plus a positive 100 is negative 300, and I'll just take that one number. So negative 4,300 plus a negative 300 is negative 4,600, and that's cash paid for inventory. Let's see, salaries, no adjustment, so it stays negative 400. Cash paid for salaries. Office expenses, no adjustment there. So basically we're saying we really paid cash for all of those office expenses. Income taxes, this year we owe $200, but we had to pay, it looks like, a bill from last year. So overall, even though we only accrued $200 based on this year's profit, we paid $700 for taxes. See, depreciation should be zero, and it is negative 25 plus 25 gives me zero. There's no cash for depreciation. I don't want to show anything anyway. Let's see, rent expense, negative 300 plus a positive 100 gives me negative 200. So my cash paid for rent is only $200. Now I'm going to add these up. So I take the 8750 plus 100 minus 4600 minus 400 minus 300 minus 7 minus 2 and I get 2650. Now the name of this depends. If I'm doing a formal statement of cash flows, then this is cash flows from operations or from operating activities. If I'm doing a cash style income statement, then this is the excess of receipts over disbursements. So it depends on what I'm calculating this for. There's our example, and that's our final number. If we were doing a full-blown statement of cash flows, we'd go on. And we take that 2650 and we turn it into cash flows. But that's not our purpose right now. We're just going to get this one number for the time being. Now, I'd like you to go ahead and flip to the next page. And you should see a cash to accruals conversion from that PDF that I gave you. What I'd like you to do is do the same thing we just did. Only difference now is we've got cash information. And you can tell because it says it's a cash flow income statement up here. It also says cash to accruals up there. But if you don't see that, it says it's a cash flow income statement. And look here, cash, 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 cash. So it must be that you have cash flow information and you're looking for accruals. So knowing that, I'd like you to do this bulldog example before you start the next segment. And then when we get back together, we'll walk through step by step and show you the numbers. Okay? So I will see you then.